probably end of September, beginning of October. And we have some revenue, but we are still early stage. I would say we have an MVP, but you know, revenue is just starting really. So we are kind of pretty much bootstrapped. We have a very little seed money in the beginning, but otherwise bootstrapped.
You're based in India or?
I'm currently in Hyderabad. I'm based out of India, yeah. I've lived in the US a long time and I'm originally from Europe and I will go there for some time now as well.
Right.
To escape COVID.
Awesome. Thank you. Anyone else wants to take a crack?
Payal, would you like to go next?
Yes, one second. Yeah. Hi everybody, I'm Payal and I'm here. I was invited by Nisha. Thank you, Nisha, for sending us the invite. And I'm a teapreneur, so I'm into the business of tea and hence I always address myself as a teapreneur. And I'm from Darjeeling, but now I live in Gurgaon. And yes, this is my third venture. The two other ventures, 2 decades of experience in hospitality. But with this venture, it's only 3 years old ever since I started this. And we have bootstrapped it and we have done good revenue. We are doing 20 million cups of tea till now. And our revenues are decent, but then now we are not able to take it to the next level. Hence, I thought, let me just hear if there's some good information which can be of use to me. That's why I'm here. Thank you, Nisha.
Thanks, Payal.
So, quick question, Payal. What were your previous 2 ventures and did you have a successful exit from those? Or?
So I was in Siliguri all my life. I just shifted to Gurgaon, as I said. So the first venture was a school that I used to run. And that was a franchisee. So that after 9 years, the franchisee owners decided to close that thing. And second was a restaurant. So I had my chain of restaurants. I had 3 restaurants in Siliguri, along with a banquet hall. Yes, I successfully took exit from it. The ventures are still running. But then I just get my royalty out of it now. And I wanted to then start into something bigger. So I started this tea venture, which was, we invested only a small amount. And more, if you want any more detail, we can take it offline.
Right.
Thank you.
Thanks. So before we go to the next participant, I would just like to welcome Shweta. Shweta is our third panelist today. Thanks, Shweta, for your time.
Hello, so, everyone.
Hi, Shweta.
Shweta, lovely to see you here.
Hi, Shweta.
Yeah.
So very happy to see all our panelists on time, bang on 3 o'clock. So Prachi, Tina, script consultant, what you see as a name, and Shweta are our 3 panelists. So moving to the next, Kalavati, would you like to tell about your venture? Kalavati, I think she can't hear. Harish, Harshita Chandra?
Yeah, hi. Because of the bad networks here, so I'm just switching off my video.
Sure.
So Upcycle Lux is a fashion platform. Where we are creating sustainable supply chain and bringing together all the designers who are manufacturing sustainable products.
Harshita, your voice is very...
I can't hear you very clearly.
Okay. Can I speak after
one? Sure.
And people feel free to drop your intros into the chat. Yeah. That would actually be really helpful for us to know who you are. Like basically one line about your name, your organization, and about your company. And also if you can share about which stage you're at, that would help the speakers and us relate with you better in today's call, because we can talk about bootstrap, we can talk about Series A also. I think we'll need to know where and how that question is coming up to us. So please, if you could drop your intros into the chat, that would be very helpful. We're going to do this for another 2 minutes. And then I think at 3:05, we'll open up and we'll have more time in your session, post your session.
All right. So now, am I audible properly?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So Upcycle Lux is a platform. It's a sustainable platform for clothing and accessories for men and women. So the brand entirely focuses on a step further in developing a green luxury economy. So we are creating brands from artisans and then who are authentically sustainable, and then they are not greenwashed. So we are bringing them together with our science-based sustainable target solutions, so we can achieve the low impact in the supply chain. So the entire venture is 6 months old. We are currently bootstrapping it. So we just wanted to know more about how to invest and how to excel in this field, in fashion industry.
Thanks, Harshita.
Yeah, Harshita.
Yeah. And Vaisha, Anveshika, would you like to go next?
Yes, hi. Just give me 1 minute. I'll turn on my video.
Yeah, we would love to see you as well.
Yeah. I hope you can see me now.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Anveshika. I got to know about Startup Grind through one of the newsletters and I was really excited to be part of today's webinar. So I work with Edupreneur Village, that is an edtech focused venture capital fund based out of Delhi. And I've been into startup investing for about 5 years now. And I will plan to open up my own venture maybe next year to help startups in their journey of fundraising.
Thanks, Anvishika.
Thank you.
Thanks. Kalawati, would you like to talk about your venture?
I think Kalawati's screen is frozen or something.
Yeah. Healthy Hustle?
Misha, let's do one last intro and then
we'll
strip drop.
So, guys, open to anyone who wants to unmute and talk about themselves. We'll just give you 1 minute.
Healthy Hustle, come on.
Yeah. Hi, this is Jill.
Hi, Jill.
Hi. Yeah, hi. I run a startup in high-end fashion rentals. We rent designer clothes for men and women for 10% of retail value. And we customize the outfits depending on your size, etc. and ship them pan-India all for free.
Awesome. Thank you.
Hi, I'll just speak up before you. Yeah.
Sure.
Hi. Well, it shows Healthy Hustle. The reason is that's the name of the online studio right now I've started on, and I do have plans of expanding in my own studio. So I'm basically a certified radio jockey, been a radio jockey for 10 years, professional anchor, a fitness instructor by passion and choices, that's what me. And so I want to expand and take it forward with a lot of, these kind of pandemics that happens. I think health, awareness, fitness, nutrition is something which is a key thing. So I want to keep that in my mind and have a very different concept of studio. So that's something which is very shortly in my mind. Let's see. So I'll also listen up what's in store. Thank you, Nisha, for inviting me over.
Absolutely. The pleasure is all mine. Thank you.
Okay.
Hello.
Hi.
Yes.
Yeah. Myself, Meeta from Chaitanya Rajguru Nagar.
Hi, Meeta.
Thank you. Nice to see all of you here.
Pleasure.
Likewise.
All right. So I think without further ado, we are going to jump into our session here. Thank you everyone for joining us on a Thursday at an afternoon time. I'm very pleased to see the kind of attention and attendance that we have received. Quickly about our moderator, this panel today has been moderated by Nisha, who's the co-founder of Her Ace Venture Evangelist. Have is an investment platform which supports women-led ventures through three nodes: investment access, knowledge access, and market access. Nisha is an experienced CEO with a demonstrated history of working with professional training and coaching. She's skilled in business planning, risk management, corporate finance, banking, and she has strong entrepreneurship intent, and she's a CA and CS. Strong business acumen to grow her business from scratch to millions. And she's passionate about building strong financial acumen in entrepreneurs, especially women entrepreneurs. So thank you, Nisha, for partnering up with Startup Grind for this particular campaign. And I'm going to hand it over to you. And once the session is over, I can talk more about the campaign once we have more audience also come in, so that I don't have to repeat myself again.
Sure.
But I'll leave it to you to introduce our beautiful speakers and talk about this panel discussion, and over to you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Karan. And now I realize that, you want to hog all the limelight at the end of the session when all the participants are there. So, great. Thank you so much, Kiran. And welcome everyone, each one of you, as Kiran said, that, it's so nice to see that so many women entrepreneurs all geared up to see how to take their venture to the next level. And and we have three beautiful, very talented, and, a true entrepreneur mindset women on our panel today. So I will start with Prachi. So Prachi, if we can say quick hello to everyone, and then I introduce your bio so that they know.
Hi everyone.
Hi. So with that lovely smile, Prachi Jain is the director of Achieving Women Entrepreneurs of Funds, which focuses on gender lens impact investing. So all the women entrepreneurs who crave that, you know, we don't have exclusive women funds, here we have the founder of Off Funds who exclusively look into the women-led ventures. She's a part of senior leadership team and core investment team member of Off Funds. She has 12 plus years of experience in private equity industry and has thorough knowledge and experience of the life cycle of the fund, including but not limited to fundraising, financial modeling, due diligence, valuation, etc., etc., etc. She is a very, very passionate about creating the ecosystem for women entrepreneurs and has been mentoring, coaching, and advising women entrepreneurs across the sectors. She was speakers at various webinars and events organized by our foundation, JSI, Empowered, Thai Women, Her Entrepreneurial Network, Climate Ready, and today have Stand Startup Grind as well. Thank you so much for your time, Prachi, and we look forward to hear about you from you once we start the panel discussion.
Sure. Thanks for the introduction.
Thanks, pleasure is all mine. So next in the panel is Tina Chopra. Tina, would you like to say a quick hello?
Hi.
Hi. So guys, Tina has a working experience of more than 12 plus years as a journalist. She succumbed to the allure of becoming an entrepreneur, and now she's enjoying a stint as an entrepreneur from last 6 years. She has worked for the world-class news organization as a journalist in Times of India, Forbes Asia magazine, and the BBC as the editor of Wealth magazine. But, the Kira, the bug of entrepreneurship bit her, and she started her journey as an entrepreneur 6 years back. She founded content marketing agency called Script 6 years ago. She's very proud of her work that she's doing. And she has worked with, again, world-class brands like A-Star, Citibank, OCBC Bank, Unilever Food Solution, KPMG Digital, and the list goes on. She's also one of the mentors for the HBSCS mentorship program, which is jointly run by alumni of Harvard Business School and LSC. Of course, we are going to hear from her more about her journey as an entrepreneur. And of course, she also wears a hat of an investment bank through a managed fund. So we'll also love to know about that, Tina.
Thank you, Nisha. Thank you, Sean.
Thanks. And next, the lovely lady in the stars, you see, Shweta. Shweta, would you like to say hi?
Hi, everyone.
Hi. So Shweta is an award-winning investment banker and a business leader. Now, we all, created our own organization and became the CEO or the MD or the director of the organization. But Shweta had to really, make her way in her organization to reach that level. So kudos to you, Shweta. How much it takes to reach to that level. She is known for her visionary leadership and strategic thinking, having set up and led various businesses to success. She is an All India rank holder chartered accountant with 18 years of experience in setting up leading teams in investment banking, audit, and retail banking across large organizations like HSBC, Goldman Sachs, PwC, and ICICI. Shweta is currently heading the Global Bank COE for HSBC, consisting of investment banking portfolio, portfolio analytics, CRM, client strategy, business research analytics, and transformation team. What I really like and connect with Shweta is like she's very passionate about equal opportunity and founded the first international branch of Diversity Network Balance in HSBC, and was subsequently nominated as global co-lead for the network. She helped expand her network to over 30 countries and 50,000 employees. Shweta has been instrumental in driving many diversity and inclusion programs and has been a key propagator for the Take Two Returnship program. Shweta is currently creating awareness and advocacy for disability hiring and mental health aspects of D&I as well as in the corporate world. I welcome you, Shweta. We would love to hear more about you from you.
Thank you for the wonderful introduction, Nisha. Humbled.
Thank you so much. So on that note, for the benefit of all our participants, I will just quickly take you to how will the entire format of the webinar would be. We'll be opening to hear our panelists for around 5 to 7 minutes, where they would share their journey as an entrepreneur, as an investor, whatever they feel appropriate that will help and benefit our audience. After their introduction, then we will get into a panel discussion where I'm going to ask them questions And I'm sure all the women entrepreneurs, you know, I know so many of them personally who are really doing quite well. If you have any question, you can always put it in the chat box. Or if you would like to ask it yourself, please raise hand and Kiran will make a note of you and will unmute you. So Kiran, when we see a hand raised, please ensure that they ask the question themselves.
Yes, Nisha.
Perfect. So, and if you're not able to take all the questions, or in case you have some question which you want to take offline, you can always reach out to our panelists. They can share their contact details, whatever feel appropriate for them, their email ID, their contact number, and you can always reach out to them. So are we all set? Can we have a quick show of hands that we all are ready? Thumbs up, and then we get going. Perfect. So now the topic, the very topic is fundraising for my venture, for the women-led ventures. So let me start, you know, hitting it at the at that very point, starting from Prachi. Now, Prachi, before I start, would you like to share about your journey as in fund house in 5 minutes?
Yeah, I'll do that. I think you have broadly covered everything, Nisha. You have just covered everything. There's nothing left. I think even Tina and Shweta will agree to that. So okay. Just to add, it's always a journey, right? So I'm also a chartered accountant. So we have the CA fraternity. So I'm a chartered accountant, company secretary, lawyer. I'm also an All India rank holder. The journey started when I was just like 20 years old, came to Mumbai with a lot of dreams. I am from Gwalior, that's my native. But I completed my CA, CS and LLB in Mumbai and then joined a firm called Ambit RSM, which got merged with PricewaterhouseCoopers. Worked exclusively in the financial services division out there when they were setting up and worked with funds like New Vernon helped them set up. This is more on the consultancy side and New Vernon and Warburg. And after that, I realized that this is not, I've done this. This is like extremely fabulous structuring this, that, but I need to go move ahead. So then started what we call as a change. And I'm fortunate enough to landed up in a job, which is a private equity job. And in 2007, my PE journey started. I worked for funds like Yes Bank's Agribusiness Fund, SEEF India Agribusiness Fund. Then joined New Leaf Consumer Fund, and now I'm currently working with AWE funds. I think I have that risk appetite of working with funds which are starting from scratch. So they're just trying in their formative stages. And that's when I joined them, helped them setting up, doing various stuff. So I think I have that, even though I will not call myself as a pure entrepreneur, but I have an entrepreneurial kida where I'm an entrepreneurial professional, and landed myself up in jobs where it's like nothing. I have to set up an organization. So I do really understand the pain point of an entrepreneur. And also I have always joined funds which are niche in their segment. So when I joined Agribusiness Fund, SEEF India's Agribusiness Fund or Yes Agribusiness Fund, there were like no funds in India. We were the first SME segment agribusiness fund in India providing funding to agribusinesses companies. Then I landed up joining New Leaf Consumer Fund, which was kind of a very small stint. And then AWE Fund. We launched it like in 2018, got our SEBI registration last year. But again, it's kind of first of its kind fund with a $50 million corpus. And we are looking at more of a pre-Series A, Series A. So yeah, so that's about me. So I can just go on and on. But I think that's more about my professional journey. And I'm actually very, very passionate about creating an ecosystem for women entrepreneurs, because I believe that this is what is lacking. There's a lot of handholding which a woman entrepreneur needs. There's a lot of capacity building which needs to be done. And the investors need to look at, women entrepreneurs slightly differently in terms of, I believe there's a lot of empathy which is needed. They are confident, very, very confident, but a lot of times they shy away from showing that confidence and they sometimes do not want to kind of move out from their kind of cocoon which they are in. So I always believe that you just can't be having one stack solution wherein you just have a fund providing funding to women entrepreneurs. And that was entirely the reason we also have our associate enterprise called as OFF Foundation, which does a lot of this capacity building programs, series for women entrepreneurs. And that's what we truly believe in, building an ecosystem for women entrepreneurs so that funding becomes easier for them. Then they need not be coming to us. Then they can go to anyone.
I think, thanks Prachi.
Maybe I exceeded 5 minutes after saying that you introduced me very nicely.
No problem, no problem. We love to hear you. In fact, I think you very briefly also answered my question, which was the very first question. You know, I speak to so many investors in my, you know, in my daily life, and I speak to so many women entrepreneurs. And every one of them, you know, complain that, you know, when we go for investments or when we really go on for pitching, you know, investors always have these biases, you know, whether they agree, you know, it's unconscious biases that there exists that, you know, whenever they have to invest in a venture that is led by women. So more than the asking them about the business model and about how are they going to generate revenue, they are more focused on that, you know, how will you manage your family, or what if your husband tomorrow asks you to take care of the family? And these are some real-time questions that they have to come answer. So they say, why are you focusing on my, you know, family life? Why don't not focus only on my professional life? So that's where, you know, so I wanted to say that, you know, and when I speak to investors, they have their own side of story. They say that, you know, when women are there, you know, we, if I really go by statistics, how many women entrepreneurs are really there to make it big? Do how many of them really have the mindset to break all the barriers? You know, barriers will exist. How many do I have? They have their own stories that, you know, when we invested and we saw there are some problems coming, some challenges coming, and women just giving up. So they're also, it's their hard-earned money they're investing in. So they're also very, very cautious about that. But having said that, every coin has both the sides, the good and the bad, the pros and the cons, and we have to really create a balance around it. And that's where my question was, that why did you choose to create a fund exclusively for women? Where I see so many investors, they just shy away for investing in women-founded, you know, women-led businesses.
Right.
They're always, don't want to take that risk appetite. So give me in two lines, Prachi, what made you create this particular fund?
So I will not in two lines, because there is a thesis behind why women fund. So I may take 2 to 3 minutes of yours for answering that question. So again, I will answer this question based on the facts rather than just telling that we are passionate about creating an ecosystem. You wanted to do this? No. So why? So as an impact investor, what an investor looks at, as you rightly pointed out, there is a commercial return and the impact. So we are an impact investor also. So we are looking at two things. One is commercial return, and second is impact, which is being created by our investments. So two points to bring forth. Empirical evidence shows that women-led teams provide 35% better returns as compared to only male-only teams. So which technically means that women are a great asset class, which provides me better returns. So that answers one of the questions as to why. The second is, women typically invest 80% back to the society as compared to 20% by men, and thus help in nation building. So technically, women creates much larger impact on society and economy as compared to only male-run companies. So these are my two whys, because these are the two reasons an investor would like to invest in a company. So if I am getting 35% better returns, why shouldn't I? Now coming to why should we start this fund, right? So what we realized after doing a research study, that this is an underserved asset class. And you also rightly pointed out, right? So as per the IFC, less than 4% women entrepreneurs are funded by VC in India. So there is definitely lack of access to equity funding to women entrepreneurs. So that also shows that there is a need for these kinds of funds. Second important thing is, there is the number of women entrepreneurs is on the rise. Currently, the number is just 14% of the entire ecosystem in India, but this number is bound to increase primarily because of three reasons. One is literacy rate is increasing. Secondly, women comprises like 50% of our population. And entrepreneurship is best suited for women, and it provides them a lot of work flexibility. So I believe these are the reasons, as when I say why and how, which led us to go ahead and start this fund. After having said this point, I would come to that logic of that we are passionate about investing in women entrepreneurs. We believe in our power. And there is a report by Gates Foundation which says that it will take 208 years for gender equality to come in if there is no formal intervention. So definitely there is a need, that there is a gap which we are trying to fill. And we also believe, as I pointed out earlier also, that there is lack of empathy
when a woman entrepreneurs go and just meet any investor, as you rightly pointed out, they're asked more of a personal questions, which I will say these are more of a preventive question rather than a promotional questions. Promotional questions technically means questions regarding how do you want to grow your company, rather they being asked, do you think you're able to manage these sales number? So I think these are the broadly, I've covered the reasons why we want to set up this fund, what were the reasons behind it. And of course, there is prevalence of unconscious gender bias. There are investors whom I have met who have always said that they really do not care unless the idea is really good. But I've also heard more than 200 plus women entrepreneurs till date. And a lot of them actually pointed out various reasons, which states a lot of times the investor tells them, oh, go onboard a male co-founder and then we'll look at you. Or something like what will happen, as you rightly pointed out, Nisha, that if you have kids, if you'll get married. So I think these are the challenges which women has to face in addition to a normal challenges of evaluating our company. So I hope I've answered that question of yours, Nisha.
Absolutely, absolutely. Beautifully answered, Prachi. And to all the women entrepreneurs out there, you know, as Prachi rightly said, that, you know, if the India really want to reach the kind of growth we are looking or targeting at, women entrepreneurs need to be given equal importance in terms of investment, in terms of market access, in terms of network access. So thank
Can
you.
Can I add to that, Nisha?
Yeah, please, Shweta.
Actually,
yes.
You know, it is really disheartening to read the numbers. Like Prachi mentioned, only 4% is being funded by VC funds, all women entrepreneurs, that is. And knowing the fact that there is so much, I mean, a business case for diversity, not only we right. talk about business case for diversity in corporates, but I think the business case for diversity amongst entrepreneurs cannot be understated. Again, I will quote what Prachi said in terms of generating 35% higher ROI. Also, the fact that, you know, women-led entrepreneurs are much, much more capital efficient because right. they don't flounder money, right? They don't
totally agree.
They are completely very conscious of how they spend their money. And I can give you a proven example of an industry which has completely flourished because of the fact that a lot of people drawing money in that model were women. So if you know, or if you're familiar about microfinance industry,
right.
microfinance industries, contributes very less to the non-performing assets of banks. And the microfinance organizations are much successful than large NBFC or banking companies because of lower NPAs. And that is because of the fact that the money that is lent is going to, most of it is going to women. So not only do they spend the money wisely, but they're also very, very committed and very accountable to pay back and commitment that if I have borrowed money, I need to return the money. So these are, you know, I don't know if you want to call it softer traits, but these are like really very, very important traits that investors need to keep in mind. And they also, from their selfish so-called perspective, the investors want to see, they would want to also gauge that there is a huge area of opportunity. Only if only 3% ventures are funded right now, imagine what kind of area of opportunity are we talking about in terms of how they can make their own money grow by investing these kind of ventures.
Yeah, absolutely. So well said, Shweta. Thank you for coming in and bringing that point. So to all the investors out there who think that women-led ventures don't give them the return. So here we have some of our panelists answering that question that, you know, if you really want 35% more returns and if you really want your money to be managed well, please invest into women-led ventures. That's where the return lies.
Yeah. And thanks, Shweta, for bringing that point out. And I will just quote, I always have that data. I mean, I've suddenly become data-oriented person. So the amount is for every dollar invested by a female run, they generally tend to generate 78 cents in revenue. Whereas male-run startups generate only 31 cents in revenue. So you can see, I mean, I'm backing your statement by a data.
Thanks.
And thanks for bringing that point out.
Thanks. So, you know, it's so heartening to see that, you know, when I talk to investors and I say that what are the top three things that you look when you invest in a venture, they always say that, you know, of course, business ideas and important, what industry that person is important, but what really matters is the founder. the softer traits, Shweta, it's not underestimated by investors. They really look into it, the traits, they really invest in the founders. So these traits, that how they are managing money, how they are dealing with things, really matters. So thanks for bringing that up. So now coming back to Tina. Now Tina has been an entrepreneur herself from last 6 years, and her company is also bootstrapped. So Tina, what do you think about as a women entrepreneur? You know, have you faced any biases per se? And if any, what are they? Would you like to share your experience there?
Yeah. So essentially, I mean, all the great points raised by Prachi and Shweta. I feel there's the other side to woman entrepreneurship, which is also, you know, something that you read in books like Lean In. So women entrepreneurs ourselves, we sometimes do not have the conviction to go and convince others about the ideas. Another thing that I felt along the journey, I have had interactions with other women entrepreneurs, you know, who are far along the journey. They're really capable. They can manage large teams. They have experience, which is, you know, they understand finance. But again, the thing about taking ownership and showing the confidence. So a buck comes back to us in certain way that, you know, we also need to be a little more assertive in getting things done, in convincing everyone. I don't think so. I'm from the journalism background, which treats everybody, which is a true meritocratic system. You know, if you, it's a very, very news-driven system. So if you get a breaking news, you get rewarded for it. And, you know, you get airtime, you get bylines. And so that system was what I came with the mindset. But when I got into business, I realized that there are many more factors. You know, access to capital is one of the factors. Again, when as a woman entrepreneur, so apart from the great introduction that you did for me, there's also one thing that apart from Script, which is a services business, I also ran a product business for which I tried to fundraise. And that unfortunately didn't take off very well. I had to close that down. That was about a couple of years ago. So when I was doing a product version for it, you know, getting things like the technical part, I'm not saying everybody is well-versed in technology, but now that we are going into an era where most of the startups or, you know, funding is going to be something which is not only old economy, it is going to be something which is a hybrid, you know, you're trying to make things better from the previous generation's access. So, you know, things like Grab or Uber or Ola in India are great examples, or Flipkart are great examples. So when it comes to technology as well, I feel there's also a need for women to take on the initiative to learn more skills like coding, to empower ourselves. Yes, that is true. We have challenges in things like access to capital, in managing everything, because again, the question comes back, you know, are you able to, women like Shweta and Prachi rightly said, you know, we are so used to multitasking. So we can be better managers, but getting every bit and piece into place also requires a lot of initiative from us as entrepreneurs, as women who really are still paving the way for the next generation, for our daughters and for our granddaughters and the generation that follows, to come and take it to the next level.
Absolutely, absolutely. Very rightly said, Tina, there's always the other side of the story. And of course, the onus ultimately lies on me. I have to take the responsibility of whether I could make it big or could not make it big. So absolutely, thanks for bringing that point. So to the ladies out there.
One thing which is more relevant at this point is that is why I think cohort support or mentorship for women is very, very relevant. Yes, access to capital is very relevant, but, you know, support that people like Prachi or Shweta can provide, you know, simple things like, you know, how to manage your finances, what are the best steps, so, you know, how to get your pitch done, simple things. So it's not only about hard cash is what I want to say. It's also about generating soft skills and building that ecosystem in which women support. It's like the sisterhood of entrepreneurship. Rather than just, so, you know, we have to create a separate sisterhood of entrepreneurship where we support each other. Doesn't matter, you know, what stage of journey are you along, but if I can help you and I can mentor you, I can support you, I should be willing and able to do that and have access to it.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think Tina very well pointed out that, you know, it's all about sisterhood. And we always, when I'm part of a lot of forums where we women entrepreneurs meet, and we always say one empowered woman empowers 100 more women. And yeah, that's what we are trying to create right now, having tying up with Startup Grind, which actually is trying to create this mentor-mentee ecosystem where, as you said, there are so many people out there who really want to mentor, but they don't know who to mentor. And there are so many mentees who really need mentors, but they don't know how to reach or access these mentors. So we are creating that ecosystem so that, you know, we match them. It's like matchmaking. And then, of course, it's up to the mentor and the mentee to take it forward from there.
Yeah.
So, thanks, Tina. So, as you said that, you know, people like Shweta, Prachi, you have to, you know, own up some responsibility in terms of mentoring or coaching. So, Shweta, coming to you now. Now, you have been, though you have been working in organization, but I, knowing you very well, that you completely work with an entrepreneurial mindset. And you never thought that I'm an employee and I'm only supposed to do this much. You always went over and beyond what you're expected to do. So what are some tips or the pointers that you would like to share with our audience here in terms of that, sometimes they want to raise funds from banks as well. Banks have some, you know, very focused funds for women-led ventures. So would you like to share some throw some light there?
Yeah, there are two ways to look at it. Like, let me first answer, you know, to get those funding from banks, what do you really need? So unfortunately right now in the current environment, everyone is stretched for funding, right? So we must be thinking as startups or as women entrepreneurs that we are kind of stuck in a place where we have huge ideas, but we don't have financing. But I can tell you that right now, due to COVID, what we're seeing is a spike in demand for financing and funding. So even large and resilient organizations have kind of crumbled under the pressure of having that need for financing. So we as banking organizations know how important, you know, funding at the right time is for our clients. And banks like really try to help our clients get that access to funding. But, you know, entrepreneurs should also know that for every penny the bank lends, the bank takes on a lot of risk on its balance sheet. So the way it works is, if I lend you, suppose, 10 million, then if the risk weighting on the portfolio that I'm holding is 10%, then I have to maintain, record a 1 million risk-weighted assets on my book. And against the 1 million risk-weighted assets that I record on my book, I need to maintain, as per the regulatory Basel III requirements, some bit of capital, say 10 to 12% capital. So I will have to maintain 0.1 million of capital. So, I mean, it's not very easy for the banks as well, and they have to be very cautious who they lend to. But banks are trying to make sure that even if they cannot commit to all the funding requirements that are actually coming to them, they form conduit. They act as conduit and connect the clients to these other capital providers, so that there is this access to capital that is continued to build out. So banks, obviously, when it looks at entrepreneurs, it prefers to have entrepreneurs who are a little perhaps settled and large and have crossed the initial couple of years in their entrepreneurship journey. So they want to have invest in companies which have tested the product and I mean, have discovered that so-called magic formula in the market. And then when they want to grow, banks usually try to invest in the growth phase because usually, I'm talking from a large banking organization perspective. Again, there are smaller boutique firms and funds which invest in some lower ticket size as well. So they want to then help out the entrepreneurs to access the market. Now, the access to market can happen in many ways. One is, if you're looking to access to an equity investment, then the bank can assist getting investors on the table. So boutique IB firms and the investment banking unit of banking organizations, what they typically do, and I can run you very briefly through what the process looks like so that when you yourself are raising money, you know what the kind of process is. So for example, if you're looking to dilute or divest a part of your stake and you come to a bank saying that this is what I want to do and I want to meet potential investors. So since the bank is very networked in the market and knows what your requirements are, knows what the industry is, also is aware of the potential investors, then they float out something like called a teaser in very technical terms. So teaser is a document which is like, you know, advertisement of a movie. It's like a trailer, you know, it gives you the necessary details about your organization without necessarily revealing the name of the organization. And only if potential investors kind of want to further show further interest, then they have to sign a confidentiality agreement, and then they get a very extensive memo which is called a information memorandum. And then further to that, if they really actually want to invest in your company, then they do extensive due diligence, financial, operational, tax, and all the different due diligence. And then there is this whole negotiation, etc., that banks help the entire process with. But obviously banks cannot assist or would not take on board all the people who come to them for access to capital or for this kind of access. They have their own parameters to see if you know, the industry firstly the industry you are in, how is that industry doing, what the future of that industry is, the macro, and like someone pointed out, the founders and the management of the company is really, really important. Because what you would have seen that a lot of investors invest in the founders, because even if one idea kind of goes bust, but they are so pro and so optimistic about the founders that they invest in the next idea for the founders, because they know that the founders would have learned from their mistakes because it's a good team. So that matters a lot, how the management is doing, how the governance of the entire bit is, how much has market welcomed your product. That is really important, because market testing is something market has to give a positive feedback, because like I said, banks and investors, they invest for growth. They don't invest at a level where, you know, you're just kind of putting your idea out there. So they invest for growth. And for them, if the market has accepted your product, then they know that now if they inject money, and that is the time that you as a startup also need to inject money. So once your product is accepted by the market, if at that point in time you don't inject more funds and money into the venture, it might lack a bit of traction. So that is the point. And if you are able to convince the bank and the investors that yes, my market has tested all the waters and it is ripe, and we are further going to be very innovative, there isn't a lot of competition, we are thinking futuristic, we are thinking in a very disruptive manner, so that we going to not see a lot of competition. So the bank will then believe in your story. So it's a combination of various factors, Nisha. It's very difficult to pinpoint one thing. It is very holistic in nature, completely starting from you as entrepreneurs to a lot of other factors. Sorry, I've taken a lot of time.
No problem, Shweta. Thank you so much. I think, you know, having heard you are women entrepreneurs, I don't know what they are thinking, but I will think 100 times before I even approach a bank law for funds. But thanks, Shweta, for telling us in so brief, but it's so much of clarity that how, you know, we always come and crib about that. What's the point of the bank being there? They're not funding. But we always have their side of story, and which we always try to overlook or not care about.
No, so I will maybe later on. I want to cover this as well. How banks are now gearing up to this whole.
Absolutely.
So yeah, that'd be very interesting to know.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I will definitely made a note of that point, and we would love to know about that. How banks will make our life easy in terms of funding. So Prachi, now, you know, coming back to you, I have seen so many women entrepreneurs cribbing about saying that, you know, what's the point? These investors ask so many questions. There are so many documents. You know, how do I even prepare for all those things? Why don't they just hear my idea and give me the money?
Yeah.
So I say it's not so easy. So now, very formally, I want to understand from you, we as women entrepreneurs, at what stage should we start, you know, looking for fund, and what are the certain preparation that we should do before even approaching any investor?
Right. So I'll take this in two parts, Nisha. So please understand all entrepreneurs out here, either women or men entrepreneurs, fundraising is a very meticulous and time-consuming exercise. And before I think that I have to go out and start doing fundraising, I should be fully prepared, and I will let you know how you'll be prepared shortly. And you should also introspect on these following questions. This is something which I want all of you to think through, or even just note down as I'm speaking out these questions. So these questions are, why do I really need to raise funds? I mean, is it because my peer is raising a fund, or do I really need it for growth? Do I need it for sustainability? Do I need it for working capital requirement? I really need to be clear. Why do I need to raise funds? It should not be a herd mentality that wo raise kar raha hai to mujhe bhi karna hai. Second is that, is this the right time? As Shweta pointed out, that no investor, so specifically in India, nobody gives money on ideation. We are not Silicon Valley, though we are now the third largest startup ecosystem in the world with so many startups which are DPIT registered. But still, we are not a country which is just given on a laptop idea. No, nobody, no funds, no angel investors gives you money only on the basis of an idea. You need to have your proof of concept. If you're going maybe for a seed round of funding or an angel round of funding, and a product market fit and with customer base as you go ahead into your growth phase. So what is the right time will be decided as to what stage of business you are in. What you also need to think is, after deciding the right time, is this the right time that I need? I mean, so there's a correlation between valuation and how much I am diluting. So a person also need to think that whether there are alternative non-dilutive sources of funding for me, something like a grant or debt at a lower rate, which I can take now, grow my business to a level where I will be less diluted, because I should not want an entrepreneur after 5 years, when they're raising a Series B round, they only have 10% shareholding in the company, and then they are least motivated to work for it. And 90% are owned by financial investor. So these are the questions, and two important questions is like, who are my investor targets? So right now, as on today, investors are bifurcated. Some are purely looking at tech companies. Some are looking at women founders. Some are impact investors. So the way we do our exercise as an entrepreneurs, you should also do your exercise as to whom should I pitch to? Will it be an impact investor or a woman investor or blah, 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 or a food and agri or a clean tech company? What is the nature of my investor should be? And what all things I'm looking from my investor as in value addition? And last question is, instead of do I lack anything in terms of do I really understand what is meant by financial modeling? What is meant by pitch deck? So do I really need to go to an accelerator and incubator before I go and start fundraising? So that's to answer the first part of my question, that you really need to think and introspect on all these questions before thinking that you really need to raise fund. Now, answering your question, Nisha, that what you really need to do. No, we will not give you money if there is an idea on an Excel, if you're not clear about it. Because as Shweta also rightly pointed out, be it bank, be it anyone who is giving you money, other than your friends and family, we look at returns from the investments which we are making. We invest to exit. We are not here because we love you. We love your idea. We love your company. But we always tell, it's kind of a marriage with a divorce date fixed, right? So we have to get divorced at one point in time where we exit from your company. So the important things which company now start preparing in terms of documentation are pitch deck. Pitch deck, I will say, it is kind of your gateway to the investor world, and it is your first impression. Please do take time in preparing this pitch deck, which needs to be crisp. It should not be a 50 pager. It just needs to be a 10 or a 12 pager pitch deck, primarily including the following: what is the problem which you are trying to solve? What is the solution which you are trying to provide? What are your products, services, which you are rendering? What is your traction to date? Where have you reached? Whether you have a proof of concept, whether you have X number of customers, you have these many number of downloadables, if it's an app. So what is your traction? What is your future go-to-market strategy? What is your market size? Please work on this, because this is really important. A lot of time what people tend to do, what, and I see a lot of entrepreneurs do, is they just have a top-down approach. They'll say, oh, the market is, let's say, an agri market. It's $350 million market. We will only cater to 2% of this market, and I think this is achievable. No. Please do the bottom-up approach. Know your customers very, very well. Second important thing, which I think is missing, is the competition analysis. Every time I see pitches from an entrepreneurs, they tend to say, no, we are unique, we are niche, we do not have a competition. Please go out, figure out who are your competitors. This will not help me, this will help you to improvise your product, to understand what's happening in the market, and also give you that edge, right? Knowledge, data and numbers and knowledge will always help you in some way in ensuring that how you need to do or how you need to cater to your competition in future. Very, very important is the team. So team really needs to be built out properly on one slide. And then the financial projections and the ask. Now, this I broadly covered. I can take one session on pitch deck, how to do that. But this, in short, like I've covered what should form part of a pitch deck. You really, really need to have a crisp, very nice pitch deck covering all your points, because you are selling it. It's kind jo dikhta hai wo bikta hai, right? So you are selling your company, you are selling your product, you are selling your services to an investor who will invest their money into your company. Second important thing which you should look at, and you really need to build onto these skills, and that's where an accelerator incubator helps a lot, is understanding your financial model. A lot of time I find not only women entrepreneurs, but even male entrepreneurs stating that number nahi samajhta hai, wo hamare finance wale bande se baat karo. Which I think is not really, really, which should not happen, because these are the numbers on which you have to deliver, right? Nahi samajhta hai to samjhiye, please. Have your assumptions set. Everything in the model is based on the assumptions, how your P&L is building up, balance sheet is building up, how your cash flows. Because once you put things on paper, you will realize, you may say, oh, I'm not burning cash. But once you put things on paper, you will realize you're burning cash month on month. And what you should do, how much you want to raise. So I think financial model helps you in knowing all those things. Third important point which I want to make is prepare well before an investor meeting. So every time you have to be confident, and it may happen that it's a bad meeting, but it really doesn't matter, because you learn something out of it. Because as you meet a lot of investors, they will come up with some idea, and maybe some may hit you. You may pivot your business, or you may have an additional vertical in your business. So what I want you to be preparing very, very well. Don't be half-baked and just go and meet an investor for the sake that nahi mujhe to fundraising karna hai. No, please don't do that, because you will never get a second chance. This is your first chance, you're getting it. You have to be well prepared. And I also find this in women entrepreneur, Nisha, that even if they know 99.9%, they lack that skill and confidence to present themselves. And that's why I want them to practice a lot, because practice makes human perfect. Vis-a-vis male, who just tend to know like 60-70%, and they may just try to show that they know 110 or 150%. So that's a common issue which I'm seeing across. And except to face rejection, I think we as women, we always feel, agar kisi ne na bol diya, oh, what will happen? As you also pointed out, ki hame to nahi karna hai. No, please accept to face that, because that will also help you in building something out of it, right? You will learn something out of it. Fourth, as I said, that please decide on your valuation range and dilution range, what is there in your mind. And lastly, if you strike a deal with an investor, then very, very crucial is that you need to do negotiate your term sheet pretty well. It should not be like, I am getting money and maine unko bola theek hai sab de diya, sign kar diya, and when the new investor is coming in, I'm actually reading my term sheet or an SH at that point in time and realizing, oh, this is what I've signed. So there should be no surprises later point in time. So these are the points I think all women entrepreneurs should consider, and they should not say ki mujhe paise nahi milte. If you have a great idea, if you are a passionate promoter, if you have a product market fit, if you have a strong team, I think nobody can say no to you.
Thanks, Prachi. And I hope all the women entrepreneurs out there are making points or notes about what Prachi is saying, because she is not just talking, because she has been experiencing it. And if you want money to be raised from the investors, these are the certain points that even I come across, that women, when they go, or forget about women, entrepreneurs per se, when they go to investors, the only bottom line they are looking at raising funds. But for what? How do you bring value on the table is very, very important. one of the I was talking to one of the investors, and he said that Nisha, I received so many pitch deck or applications for money at idea level, and he say I just go by one, I just outright reject it because ideas are cheap, execution is tough. So I am not going to put my penny on ideas. So very well said that, and to the audience out here that, of course, you really need to make your pitch deck. It's like if you want to take your, she spoke about marriage and divorce. It's like if you want to take your daughter or son for getting married, you really need to ensure that he or she is at her best that time. So absolutely. Thanks, Prachi. So come now, you said that, you should really know that, do you really need money? I have seen so many, in fact, I think last week, me and Prasun, who is the co-founder for HAB, we were talking to one of the female founder, and we realized that, she wants 50 lakh to 1 crore funding, but what she really lacks is not the funding. What she really needs is the marketing support, the network support. She doesn't need funding at all. So that actually happens, that we don't realize, we just think that everybody is raising fund, it's a money making industry, let me also make money in the startup world. So coming to you, Tina, you have been running a very, very successful organization from last 6 years, and again, for the benefit of audience, it's a bootstrap. It's very easy for Tina, with kind of profile she holds, the kind of company she runs, she can go out in the market and raise funds, but she chose not to. So Tina, my question to you is, why you didn't never think about getting funded? What stopped you from not going out and preparing a pitch deck, so-called pitch deck, for the investors to get funded?
So before I begin, I mean, Prachi, fantastic, such wonderful points. I wish, somebody had told this to me at the start of my journey, which nobody did. I had to, learn the hard way. Fantastic. Anybody who's listening, if you want to fundraise, these are great, great points. Like I said, I did have another company that was a product company. And so all the things that Shweta or Prachi have said are exactly what tied in my case as well. There is a cost to capital. Capital is not free. I'm also an investor. We don't do a large ticket size. I run a managed fund. So when I wear the investor hat, so we've invested now in 7-8 startups, which is only angel funding. So that's the life cycle, right? You have friends and family network, how you begin in your garage or whatever, or on a tissue paper, you write your business plan, you get your team together, you go about it. And then you go to angel, then you go to series A, B, and then you really need an exit strategy, whether it's M&A or whatever. Now, for services companies, so you, again, like everybody said, I knew from the very beginning that, this is a services model. It's like consulting, which has to be bootstrapped. So you see consulting model around the world. If you get it right initially, it will be self-sustaining. And that has happened, apart from glitches like this year or the financial crisis, which are, of course, business has its own cycle. There will be ups and downs. You do some projections, you don't meet those projections. So again, I have also had to pivot. So, which is a great part of learning as an entrepreneur, you pivot all the time. You start with your basic idea. Even if you have funding, you don't have funding, you need to evolve with what the market throws at you. So for Script itself, most of the times, when people raise funds, what are the funds used for? They're either used to hire new professionals that will grow the market, it'll use for business development, or most of the money in B2C is actually spent on marketing, right? Social media outreach on traditional media. Now, the advantage I had was, because I'm from the media background, I could use that knowledge to just bootstrap and continue to grow. Again, I didn't want to dilute, like Prachi said, what is the point? This is a self-sustaining business, which, come rain or shine, it'll give me bread and butter. So you need to know what you're in for. This consulting model or services model is a bread and butter model, which will not give you like obscene valuations. I'm not going to become a billionaire out of it, but I will be able to pay my bills. So that is what you need to understand. What is your journey? what is it you're planning to achieve with your startup? You know, is there a plan? Do you know, not everybody can be, and among all the great things we've discussed is also that 9 out of 10 startups fail. So to run a business successfully for 6 years is itself an achievement. So not everybody can, not every business can scale up to be a multi-billion dollar business. You know, there are models which can, and there's certain models which can't.
Absolutely. Thanks, Tina. Thanks. So what I really took away from your, points is that please think that what are you in for? Do you really want the funds? Because if investors come in, they don't just come with funds. They can come with lot of question answers, lot of accountability, lot of responsibility. Are you in for that? Do you really want to be answerable to an external party because they put their money in? So, you know, it's easier said than done that, okay, just fund my, but come along with investors comes a plethora of, I don't want to use the word problems, but a plethora of responsibility and accountability. Are you in it for that? If you are, then of course you go a further step. If you are not, of course you build a self-sustainable model and as a traditional organization, try to grow your company. Thanks, Tina. And Tina is a great example, though she is very humble to say that only bread and butter, but I'm sure knowing about her, she's an avid traveler and she has traveled more than 70 countries. So I'm sure that only with bread and butter, you can't do that. So thanks, Tina. Thanks for bringing that.
And Nisha, I just wanted to add, with the startup ecosystem being so good in India now, I think a point which I want to make is, as an entrepreneur, just don't think that mujhe investor, if I've got an investor, oh wow, don't get overwhelmed with it.
Yeah.
You have a right to choose your investor, because as you rightly said, it comes with plethora of problems also a lot of times, because when it goes, it tanks, then there will be a lot of issues which crops between a promoter and the investor. So you also have to think your investors very thoughtfully now.
In fact, when I go and speak to women entrepreneurs who are looking for funding, I always say them, it's not a one-sided game. It's a partnership that you're getting into. So don't feel that they are doing any favor to you by giving you money. No, they are not doing any favor. They see something in you. They know that they're going to get returns out of you, and that's precisely they're putting their money in. So don't be mentality that, you know, thank you, you've given me money. No, they're not doing any favors.
There has to be an alignment of interest is what I will say. This is 3 words which I want to use. Alignment of your interest and that investor's interest. If it's not there, please leave it. That's just my advice.
One point I would like to add to Prachi's is also, you know, the investor that you choose can open doors for you.
Yeah.
So one of the very important factors why you choose to go with certain investor is because of the community they bring. Right. They will, because they have invested in you and they want to see that exponential growth in your startup, they will make sure that you are introduced to the right market, you're introduced to the right people, you have access to the right technology.
So
the investor that you choose will actually determine your growth trajectory. Because if you choose somebody who is not an expert in your field, like agri in your case, or somebody who's just doing publishing, so there are investors who have niche. You know, some investors only invest in agri, some investors invest only in AI, in technology. So you have to partner with them so that you have the advantage of using their network to grow your startup.
Right. Absolutely. Thanks. Okay, thanks, agree. Tina. Thanks, Tina. Thanks, Prachi. So, Shweta, you just mentioned that, you know, there are certain easier ways to get funds out of banks. And I'm sure all the women entrepreneurs out there are just waiting to hear that.
So I would not say easier way. I just want to tell you that, banks are warming up, honestly, to the idea of funding women entrepreneurs. And they are taking a lot of steps to make sure that they come to the same level, because clearly investment process requires everyone to have a lot of documents and a lot of financials and background and operational history and all of that. So far, that was the requirement by all the banks, but banks gradually are wanting to invest in the entrepreneurship space through a lot of sort of programs that they have come up with. And I'll tell you one key reason, which you should also use as a lever when you approach banks, is all the banks are wanting to create some kind of impact in the society. And they do also have sustainability goals. Also, the fact that diversity is key part of all the banks' agenda. So as part of the sustainability goal for bank, one of the sustainability goals is gender diversity, right? And gender equality. So banks, apart from making sure that they are only investing in green bonds and helping those kind of environmental causes, really do care about diversity causes. So diversity is high on their agenda, and they do a number of things internally. There are N number of programs to promote diversity, but now banks have realized that that is not enough, right? Just promoting diversity and being an equal opportunity employer is like a fashion of the past, you know. In the new age world, you have to also externally make that kind of impact around all your social and sustainability goals, and one of them is gender equality. So almost every bank has one such program. And you need to know, if you really are very keen on getting yourself funded to the bank, you better do your research. You need to know what is that program that that bank has, which you can tap into to make your case to them. So for example, like today, because I'm not speaking on behalf of any particular bank, I'm just representing my individual views. I'll talk about some of these programs, not necessarily only the organization that I work for. But let me start with the organization program that I work for. There is a program called Gender Lens Finance. So in this program, again, there are three wings. What the bank tries to do is they help women entrepreneurs through by access to capital. By access to capital, for sure, it means that the banks will not have the same kind of thresholds or the same kind of requirements when it comes to documentation or KYC or all of the operational and financial history requirements that they have for some of the other people who come to them for funding, because this is one program that they want to sponsor and invest in for their sustainability goals. So for HSBC, that program is a Gender Lens Finance program. The two other parts of that program is banks also want to make sure that they're promoting gender diversity across in the industry by selling their products and services at a lower cost to other organizations which show a high gender equality or gender diversity. Now, obviously that promotes gender diversity and equality wider in the industry, but how that benefits you, if you yourself towards gender equality and you have a diverse bench strength and you are progressing and moving towards that cause, then the products and services that you are getting from a bank can be issued to you at a discounted rate. Because it's not only about funding, like Prachi and Tina were mentioning. You need to really understand, do you really need capital investment or do you need working capital? Right. So if you need working capital, you don't always need an equity investment. You can go to a bank or NBFC or, you know, smaller funding companies to get you funds in the form of a loan or a debt. And when you take that, instead of paying the very high coupon rate that you generally pay, if you are able to meet the sustainability goals or whatever that program is asking you for, then you can get the same product and services at a much cheaper rate. And those are special schemes. And we also are partnering with our commercial banking arm. Our commercial banking arm is an arm which looks at MSMEs. So obviously MSME size is also big enough, but then there are special programs for entrepreneurs and more so for women entrepreneurs and startups. So you really need to know which organization are you going for and get some sort of insider on what programs they run. And try to go through that program, because if you just generically go and say that, hey, I need funds and I'm not meeting any of your requirements, then you might not land in the right place. You need to know what is the program and who's leading that program and approach the right kind of individual in the organization. So similarly, Goldman Sachs is running an entrepreneurship cell, but apart from also running a women entrepreneurship cell, they have invested some certain part of their capital to support women entrepreneurs. Similarly, Morgan Stanley has one program which gives impetus to women entrepreneurs, JP Morgan, Barclays, UBS, and then there are funds, you know, there are funds created more than only banks investing. You should not only look at banks from an investment perspective, you should look at how banks can help you in this journey overall. So sometimes banks themselves might not invest, but banks have access to all these money of various other individuals. For example, banks have an asset management arm, right? So in asset management, people put in money for asset managers, portfolio managers to manage that money for them. So apart from only investing ET, debt, see, now manager also starting funds of startup. So they are creating funds which invest only in startups. Then we need to know which are those banks which have such funds, whose investment management arm invest in funds that invest in startups, and then pitch to those fund managers that, you know, we are a startup. So you really need to be very thought about how you approach. See, approaching a VC and PE is different. You know that they invest in the form of equity, and it's pretty simple. You know, it's very black and white. But if you want to approach some of the other financers, then you need to know and approach it in a very right way. And then I am not saying that you would never get funding. It is slightly difficult route, but you will definitely, if you pitch yourself right and find the right route and right programs through which you can go to organization, you will absolutely be honored. For example, you know, a lot of people had come to me that they had taken a break in their career and they want to join back financial services industry. And we had put in their CVs, and it never kind of then worked. But then we launched a Take Two program, which was a women returnship program. So through that program, the women who applied had a much higher success rate. And for, say, 2 years, been trying to get into our organization, got through the Take Two program because they did it in a targeted way. Because the program was running, and then they submitted the program was wanted to get more candidates. So you have to kind of align the timing and the individual to whom you go and approach. So that is what I want to say, that there are multiple organizations, not only banks. Banks definitely are leading this, but a lot of other organizations are also running multiple programs. So please know how you can cater to Ramesha herself can talk a lot, because Nisha has been a part of entrepreneurship. One more lady panel today, participant who's also been a part of Goldman Sachs program. So they can offer you a lot of advice on how to get about, go about that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thanks, Shraddha. Thanks. So to our women entrepreneurs out there are ample opportunities out there. You just need to do your homework before you approach anyone. So, you know, we say that there are not enough opportunities. I always say that, you know, I'm so glad that I am born as a girl, as a female, because out there, everybody wants to make women more empowered. We are already empowered, and everyone is also struggling to make us empowered. So we have a double advantage. So take that advantage and move forward. There are enough opportunities, and everybody wants to help us. So let's not, you know, just stay put. You have to keep putting on your efforts. So I have so many list of questions that I've made, but I see, you know, time running, and I'm sure my audience will kill me if I don't give them opportunity to ask you questions. So I will open it for next 10 minutes to the participants. The only thing is that please unmute, and also let the panelists see your face as well. So that tomorrow, if you go to them for mentorship or funds, they recognize you. So,
I have shared a list of questions with you that have come up in chat.
Yeah, so I can see Pooja have a question right away. Pooja, could you unmute and ask a question yourself? So guys, if you have any question, please unmute and show your face and ask the question. Or I have a list of questions to ask. So anyone out there?
Hello.
Yeah.
Hi, this is Preeti here.
Yeah, Preeti.
in an entrepreneurship, I just wanted to know, like, funding isn't one part of it, but other than this, it's also getting your own clients, which is the toughest part of it. And actually, I started my own service, like consultancy, but due to clients, not getting clients, I had to again close it down. Again, now I'm thinking of it, but getting a client is a tough part for me. So how to go further for this?
So thanks, Preeti. How to get the clients? I think not you. All of us struggle with that that question. Right from, I think, Shweta, who is heading a global division in a multinational bank, to people like you and me who are running small organizations. But because it is related to consulting, let Tina help you with some nuggets that how do she go about getting the clients, Tina?
Right. So, Preeti, if I may ask, what kind of consultant are you? What
recruitment? What? Recruitment services.
Right. Right.
Working as a sole proprietorship. I was working as a sole proprietorship. I did got good clients, but you know, for recruitment, there is a lots of competitions, and now the organizations have their own listing of top 10 companies whom they deal. So yeah. Now they don't deal with the small startup organizations and all that things. So.
Yeah. I mean, that truly is a challenge. Business development is a challenge. So again, the whole idea is actually to use. So I will give you my example. I started Script with a co-founder, and then both of us, you know, because we were ex-journalists, we knew people, and then we actually asked them to give us work, to be honest, initially. So if I knew Shweta when I had started out, I would say, Shweta, can I do a newsletter for you? The market rate for the newsletter is whatever, 3,000, and I will do it for you for 1,000. And I use that as a big ticket, you know, portfolio or to showcase, and then get more clients, because now everybody knows Shweta, knows her company, you know, then it's easier. That's the way to go about it. In consulting business, the whole thing is that your margins, actually the margins of business, like Prachi said, you need to keep an eye on the margins, have to be about 70%. Otherwise, you're not going to be profitable. They're going to be bad years where you know, you may not have work. So try and get empaneled. One great thing now to do is to find a niche. So if you are recruiting, find a niche to do only AI or, you know, NLP, I don't know, you know, big data kind of recruiting for very, very different clients who may be looking to outsource. So there are various ways you can do it. Do a website, invest in digital marketing, because now if you're doing recruiting, you can have a talent pool in India, but you can cater to an international audience. So the market is really huge.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Tina. I think I got one question for Prachi, saying that it's a direct question. Do you invest in solopreneurs? You know, if it's 100% led by women, would you like to invest in such a company which had a potential in it?
Of course, yes. Why not?
Okay, so here's the answer.
I mean, that's the question. We say Mamta, that.
Mamta asked that question, you know.
So I'll make.
Hi, Nisha. Hi, Nisha, okay. Prachi.
Hi, Mamta.
Yeah, why I ask? Because I am that. And I have my own self-doubt. If I have understood that the market always funds only ventures which have a team. And if it's a woman-led, then at least there has to be one more person. At least one more person, be it man or a woman. So, solopreneurs are generally not encouraged.
So,
because it's very...
Got your question. And so, I'll just say, so just to tell you about Achieving Women Entrepreneurs Fund, I'll make just one statement. We invest in innovative enterprises that promotes gender balance. And how we do that? We do that by investing in women-owned, led, and influenced businesses. So when I say woman-owned, you are falling under that category. So that's my gating criteria. And then I will have my other criteria of looking at your business, right? And secondly, why a lot of investors ask that you have to have more than one founder. And I'm not telling to have a male co-founder. The reason being, it's like when you grow. Right now, it's like a chotu business for you. But when you reach that level of 5 crores or 10 crores, you need to build a team, which you can, it's kind of a professional team, which you really need to build. And for that, you need a founder or you need a co-founder, right? You can't be running and going and doing BD. You can't be running and doing marketing. You can't be running and your fundraising. I will tell you, fundraising is an exercise which will take 6 to 12 months of your official time, which implies that agar aap fundraising karo to aap ka kaam nahi kar sakte. You can't run your business. Okay. Kyunki ab haan aap se itna data maangenge jaise Nisha bol rahi hai, to aap kaise karoge? Either you focus on this or this. If you have a co-founder, then it eases you out. You divide. There is a division of work between you two. Aap usko bolo, bhai behan, jo bhi. I mean, what I'm trying to tell you is co-founder should be taking care of this. I will be taking care of this. Then there is a team. Because we are looking to invest in companies which have the potential to be market leaders, right? So, if you're just thinking ki solopreneur karte karte main ek 1000 crore ki company ho jaungi, no, that will not going to happen. So, you really need to open up my mind. And there's one point, Nisha, which I want to bring forth is, there are a lot of women entrepreneurs whom I've met and they say that we do not want to build a team because we think we can do it. And I think Mamta also pointed that out. So, the point I'm trying to tell is that think on building a team because you are not here to just have a 10 crore company. No, I want you to have a 1000 crore company in 5 years or 10 years from now. See that potential within you if you have a great idea. Why do you shy away from not having a team is my question, in fact, to you now.
No, I'm not shying away from that. It's, you know, this is a unconscious, I would say, like, there is an inherent problem with women. We network less, which I realized after my 15 years of software career. When I quit my career and wanted to become a business person, I realized that I was zero on my network. And that's when I started building my network, actually.
Add me also into it. I just started networking 2 years back.
Okay.
I've always been like that hardworking. I'm just doing my work. I've done my
I
used to network with people whom I love, my friends.
I can see so much of excitement in Mamta and Prachi. And I really want to say you brought a very, very valid point that, you know, forget about you, Prachi, Mamta, you know,
it's very common.
Yeah. And I always see women saying that, you know, I don't want to be out of the house after 8 o'clock. I can't go and network in dinner events. I have to say you are an entrepreneur. Don't think you are a female or a women entrepreneur. You are just an entrepreneur. And it takes time to build on relationship. And what network I built today, if I know Shweta today so well, it's not that I have known Shweta only for a month. I have been building to build this relationship with Shweta from last 7 to 8 years. Whether she knows or not, but my every small steps towards knowing Shweta, it's very, very, you know, it's about building relationship. It doesn't happen over time. And I see a lot of women saying, yeah, I go there, I just meet, I just don't enjoy it.
And so I would like to just validate by saying that when Nisha asked me for this session, you know, I didn't even ask her what this session is about. She told me Thursday, 3 p.m., can you spare an hour for me? And I said, weekday, it's difficult, but for you, I will make it happen. And then later on, I asked her, okay, what do you want me to do? Like, you know, that was the amount of confidence and trust I had in her because we've known each other for years. And, you know, although we've not worked together, her networking skills is amazing. And that's what we all need. We all need to be networked and we all need to be strategically networked as well. And please do not think that if you are strategically aiming and networking with someone, you are selfish or it's, you know, out of your value system. Or please, those things. Actually, everyone knows that networking is important and networking has to be done very strategically as well because you have only so many hours in a day and you have a purpose. Why are you talking to individuals? And when you're networking, important to also know that first, often you have to give to the individual in front of you. It's not that you go and ask someone for something right away. First, you just go with a helpful and open and friendly mindset that you can also help the person ahead of you, in front of you, and then the person will naturally give back to you.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. And just to add, I know Nisha only for a week and I just said yes without knowing what is coming my way. So that's also, so the point I'm trying to bring out here is that I was reading a course
Prachi, unable to hear you. Your voice.
Prachi, I think your voice is breaking. Prachi.
Put on a line. side.
Prachi, your voice is breaking. I think we will wait for Prachi to connect back.
Not supporting a woman will then. Can you hear me?
Now I can hear you. Yeah.
You can? No. So I was just.
Yeah. Now we can, yes.
Yeah, no, so I was just trying to say that I read a quote somewhere which states that a woman not supporting a woman will go to hell. It's on a lighter
side. Yeah, so...
But it's that we should, as a community, should network with each other and also psychologically. We always say that there is a boys' club, but there is no women's club.
I think what Prachi is saying, that there's no men's club, there's no women's club.
Right.
Club.
Yeah. So other than those kiddie parties, women are not. I mean, I can't just go and call Shweta. Can you, if I would have known Shweta, I would have called up. And we also feel kind of, just like Shweta have asked, like we have to give. But I've seen a lot of my friends who are guys, they just call up and they don't feel guilty after giving a call only for the purpose of need, right? I will kind of do 5 minutes of chit-chat and then I will say, oh, I wanted this, right? What's in harm in asking, giving a call to Shweta, Shweta, I need this from you. Which I think is a trait individual to women. We can't help it, but we really need to work on it. We really need to change this.
Absolutely. As you rightly pointed out, Prachi, that we always think that asking for a favor is a bad thing. But it is not. You asking is somebody's give and you giving is somebody's ask. So it's a community we need to grow together. And Tina, you come from, you work with big brands. We talked, which is all about corporate presence, about personal branding. So what is your, some nuggets to these women entrepreneurs when they go out in the market to create a brand for themselves? And I know this topic is also very close to Shweta. So after you, I'm going to move to Shweta.
Yeah. I mean, I feel personal brand building is really very, very important. Like I said, networking is also very, very important. But I don't recommend that you build your brand around something which is not truly yourself. So a brand has to be something authentic, something that brings out the special power that you have and special values that you can bring. And a brand building is more than just putting yourself out there in terms of what your achievements are. Brand building is also a system of referrals. You know, so I reach out to Prachi. Prachi helps me. That builds her brand. You know, so it is also truly how you network and help and do what you can do for others. Again, like in any brand or any product, which we know, you know, there is something that people will do for free. So there, again, when you reach out to people or people reach out to you, there are certain things that people believe in. That resonates with their value system. They will do it for you for free.
Absolutely.
So reach out, lean in, take advantage, build your own brand by helping people in what you can support them in.
Absolutely.
Nisha, I have a question.
Yeah,
so when it comes to investment, people often project themselves in a certain manner and trust is something that is very difficult, especially in open networking events. And when you are talking about your particular business avenue and when you're representing to investors or networking outside, if someone reaches out to you and, you take this leap of faith and you kind of have this trust that you have, what would you say would be your way to validate in terms of honesty or due diligence? Of course, when you look at the finance and you open up the bank statements and all is there. But there's intellectual property, there's so many different aspects. How do startups trust investors? Is an NDA valid? This is one question that didn't necessarily get addressed. So I think anyone on the panel.
Yeah, so a very valid question. In fact, a lot of women out say that when I go and network in open forums and I don't know who are the people and some people make tall claims. How do I really ensure that I'm talking to the right person? Or how do I really get that, what he's saying is trustworthy? So I think, Shweta, would you like to take this question? Because you also are very high on networking. How do I ensure that I'm talking to the right person?
So I think it comes through experience. I wouldn't say that every time you will hit the nail on the head. You you have to be open to failures. I mean, I think it just comes by experience, and one experience of talking to someone over a conference or investor meeting is not enough to get that kind of valid trust on that individual. So when it comes to trust, I would like to say that trust is a very important component of your branding as well, and making sure that you base your brand on trust is going to go a long way. So when we talk about brand and trust, you know, we have to talk about a company called Apple, right? We all know that, you know, it will deliver what it has promised to deliver. So I will just end with a very short story, which talks about maybe which hinges on this trust. So when this iPod was launched, then the engineers went with a prototype to Steve Jobs, and the prototype looked like a little bulky when compared to Apple products, but it had all the features that Steve had asked for. So then they said that this is the prototype we are going to go to market with. Steve said, no ways, this does not like align with the expectations of our brand and what the customers want of us, because we are also known for simplicity and creating less bulky and more like easy to use products, and it absolutely is not in the same bucket. So they said that because it has so many features, we can't make it any smaller than this. Then Steve dropped that iPod in a water body or a bucket of water, whatever, and bubbles were coming out of it. So he said that, look, we have space and we can do better than that. So what I'm trying to tell you is that to build trust, when you have made a commitment, even if you have made a commitment which is difficult for you to achieve, then you have to stand to that commitment. You have to deliver to that commitment, and you have to keep your word. That is extremely important in developing that trust. Trust does not come with one conversation or just, you know, having a casual chat in a coffee. It comes through a relationship, and that is a very, very important tenet of branding. If a person once trusts you, maybe you've made a very difficult commitment and you are so eager to just call up and say that, hey, look, I was over enthusiastic and I cannot deliver on my commitment. Don't do that. Even if you were over enthusiastic and you made a promise, keep your promise. And next time, just make sure, don't overpromise. But that, at that moment, for that time, keep your promise, because your customer base will form because of trust. That is how you win clients.
Yeah, I mean, I completely agree with Shweta. The rule in consulting is always underpromise, overdeliver.
Yeah.
Always underpromise, overdeliver.
But and once you have promised, don't go back.
Deliver. Yeah, exactly. At least deliver what you've promised.
Yeah.
Right.
We're almost at time. I think we just request everyone to consent that we can probably extend for another 5-10 minutes.
Sorry, I really have to drop off. Yes. I had a hard stop. Okay.
Absolutely.
But it is wonderful being amongst.
Can I request everyone to start their video? Is that possible? So we take a quick picture. Shraddha, just a second if they do.
All right.
We'll take a quick picture. Otherwise, we'll let you go. So I request all the people who are there, we'll just take a quick picture. The ladies, all the beautiful ladies, let's see. And we have Nita, Ashita. Men can also be there, no problem. We are also very, we also allow diversity and inclusion.
I'm a guy, but I'm still a guy.
Preeti, Soumya, Dhwani, Mamta, Smita, Richa, Atisha. Can we have the pictures? So, quickly I will take a picture. Okay, whoever is there. Thank you. So, Yashweta. So, we leave. Yashweta, if you could leave your email ID on the chat box so that people can reach out to you.
Sorry, I'm logging in through my office and we don't have chat facility.
No problem. So, I will share your personal
share my personal ID. Yeah.
I will do
okay.
that. Thanks. Thank you so much, Shweta. Thanks for your time.
Thanks,
lovely
Shweta.
Having
Bye.
You.
Nice meeting Thanks, you. Bye-bye.
Lovely. Bye, and it was Shweta. Wonderful to meet you. And Prachi.
Thank you so much for your
it
time.
It was nice to meet you as well. Bye.
Bye. Thanks, Shweta.
Bye.
Thank you.
So on that closing note of Shweta, Tina, what's your closing statement?
Closing statement, this was a great experience, first of all. Thank you so much for making me a part of it. I hope we were able to cover things that will help you know, future entrepreneurs. So I see that the life stages that everybody is very, very different. Some are starting out. Some, from the initial chat we had, people are experienced. So, you know, the needs of experienced entrepreneurs are totally different from the needs of, you know, people who are starting out. People who are starting out will need more help from people like Prachi and Shweta in understanding what the requirements are in case they want to scale up. And to make a successful startup, there are many, many things. But most important takeaway is focus on four things which are very relevant. If you're not getting a team in place, you should know why. Team is very, very important. Your product, of course, product or service is very important. You should get your financing in and business development in view. So no business can be successful if you don't have projections. You can't project what you are going to be. And again, fundraise, depending on whether you actually need to fundraise or not, and what is it that you want to achieve from a business. A product business is different from a services business, is different from an impact investing or impact venture. So that's my two bits. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And those two bits are worth millions. Thank you so much. She's into consulting business. Go and ask for her advice. She will charge you a bomb.
Yes.
So Prachi, your closing statement.
So my closing statement will be to all entrepreneurs out here, try building out sustainable business model. I think WeWork IPO, we have realized, and what has happened like with Tiger Global, SoftBanks, everybody losing onto their money. What is really needed is sustainable business model. Investors now do not want to invest in companies which is burning cash month on month over a period of 24 months. I think COVID again is a time when which have taught investors, and we have always been talking about it, and we have been told that you are traditional investors, you don't understand growth, let it burn profits and let it burn money, it really doesn't matter, they should reach X amount of growth. But I think building sustainable model is really, really important. Try bootstrapping your business from getting money from friends, family, relatives, or any through your contacts, if you can find some angel investor who will not like kind of also come and give you those kinds of advice and become your mentor or an advisor. After you have reached a particular level, please go out and do fundraising, because it's not like ki maine ek idea soch liya, let's go out and do fundraising. No. Please. Because what I've seen suddenly, Nisha, is everybody is thinking that they are entrepreneurs, which is very good. It gives you work flexibility. But funding is not for all entrepreneurs. You really need to, and also one more point, you really need to understand, there are few businesses which are fundable and there are few businesses which are non-fundable. Absolutely. If you are in a category which is non-fundable, whatever you will do, you will never get funding from investors. So these are my closing two cents or whatever you want to tell.
Thanks, Prachi.
I wish all of you all the best for your fundraising and in your businesses. Happy to help and assist in whatever way I can.
Thanks, guys. So I will share Prachi's and Tina's email ID to you in case you want to reach out to them over email. Kiran, your closing statement?
No, I think it's been very interesting to hear a full women lineup for the last, I think, 40 days for me. And we've been promoting a mentorship program, and like we've got 6-7 partners on board. And we tried to kind of collaborate all our efforts and put a united front. This campaign is to kick off an alliance of organizations who share similar values, who put the community first and are willing to accept that the community can choose which kind of mentorship they want, who they want to pick up investment from, and get access to the events across the board. Instead of like operating in silos, the ecosystem was interesting. In a way, it's working out because women are a niche in the entrepreneurship space. I think only 5% of the registered startups in this country were women founded. So I'm guessing the gender lens, Prachi shared some very interesting facts. I haven't gone into that much depth, but I would say that it's a personality thing. For me, masculine, feminine exists in both. And I think men need to learn that empathy and emotional quotient, and the softer things, you could say, the yin-yang. But overall, I think it was a fabulous panel. Thank you, Nisha. Thanks, Kiran.
And guys, to all of you out there, I am a co-founder of, again, a platform called Her Is Venture Evangelist. And I also have my co-founder, Prasun, here. Prasun, would you like to say hi? And don't go by his background, okay? That is not the real office, okay? So we are also trying to create a platform where we want to help and support women entrepreneurs who have already a business running in place, to give them fund access, growth access, market access, and network access. So please feel free to reach out to any one of us. You, Kiran, who can give you the contact details as well. It was lovely to have you this afternoon. And my heartfelt thanks to Tina, Prachi, and Shweta, who is not around, but really the kind of points you guys brought about in the panel discussion, it was so focused, so beneficial. I myself, I'm an women entrepreneur from last 8 to 9 years, but there was so much of learning from me as well. So thank you so much for your time, and have a great, great Kiran?
Before we close, the people who have raised questions whom we couldn't address, they had a particular list of them. We would try to, I would suggest that instead of us trying to put this together, we will be sharing the contact details of our speakers and an email address. If you don't get an answer from them, or you can write to Nisha also, so that opportunity is still there. I just want to let you know. Sorry, the time was a little...
No problem. Absolutely.
Thank you, Nisha and Kiran, for a wonderful session. Thank you, Nisha. You did great. And for people who are here, let me tell you that she's been really working hard. She's been chasing us for the last couple of days, you know, telling us what we should expect and priming us and running the questions. So thank you so much for all your hard work. And thank you, Kiran, for a wonderful and beautifully managed session.
Thanks,
Nisha. Thanks, Kiran. We have to chat. I mean, it will be a long one. Our conversation that you want to have. And thanks, Tina. It was lovely, meeting
to see you.
Yeah, and wishing you all the best. Thanks, Kiran. Thanks, Prasun. I take your leave. Bye-bye.
Bye,
bye,
guys.
Thank you so much. Bye.
Thank you, everyone.